This is Binghamton Now on News Radio 1290 WNBF Binghamton and WNBF.com.
Where news breaks first, News Radio 1290 WNBF.
This is News Radio 1290 WNBF News. Mostly sunny for today, high near 57. Increasing clouds tonight, low around 37. Rain is Saturday afternoon, high near 46. Sunday rain, possibly mixed with snow showers, high near 41. The First Ward Action Council announced they are now accepting applications for the new Vestal Chateau Apartments at 2040 Route 26 in Vestal. The complex will offer 30 units consisting of 20 one-bedroom and 10 two-bedroom apartments designed for affordable senior housing. Monthly rent will range from $529 to $768, including heat, water, and sewer expenses. Amenities in each unit include modern kitchen and bath spaces, energy-efficient heating systems, and accessibility features for individuals with mobility, hearing, and visual impairments. 7 units are tailored for mobility-impaired individuals, 2 for those with hearing and vision impairments, and 5 for frail elderly seniors. All ground floor units are adaptable for wheelchair accessibility. The deadline for all applications is March 29th. A lottery will be held on April 12th at the First Ward Action Council. The Vestal Chateau apartment complex is expected to be completed in late April. Interested individuals can contact the First Ward Action Council for more information and an application. According to the Broome County Sheriff's Office, on February 14th, the Crimes Investigations Unit, along with K-9 Marley, were conducting a search of female-occupied K-dorm. Marley alerted investigators to the presence of narcotics at one of the bunks assigned to Heather Availers of Owego. A plastic bag containing gray powder tested positive for heroin, and Availers was charged with promoting prison contraband in the first degree and criminal use of drug paraphernalia in the second degree. The second incident occurred in the male-occupied F-pod housing unit, where with the help of K-9 Marley, the CIU conducted a cell search that housed Marvin Green of Binghamton. As investigators arrived to enter Green's cell and conduct a search, he was found flushing his toilet multiple times as investigators entered his cell. Green was uncooperative and struggled with officers while attempting to conceal an item on his person, according to the Broome County Sheriff's Office. Green was charged with promoting prison contraband in the first degree, attempting to conceal, alter, and destroy physical evidence, and obstructing governmental administration in the second degree. Several New York City employees have been arrested for their alleged role in a scheme to steal the identities of homeless shelter residents and defraud a pandemic-era relief program. Manhattan prosecutors brought charges against 18 people, including 5 employees of the city's homeless services agency. Prosecutors said they abused their positions to access the personal information of homeless shelter residents, which they used to obtain $1.2 million in pandemic unemployment benefits. Employees of the New York Police Department, the MTA, and the U.S. Postal Service were also charged in the scheme. Each of the defendants who were arraigned on Thursday afternoon pleaded not guilty to charges that included grand larceny, conspiracy, and burglary. On Thursday, Mayor Jared Cram of Binghamton announced details of the 2024 Binghamton Business Plan Competition. The annual Binghamton Business Plan Competition awards $5,000 to the individual or team that submits the best plan for developing a business in the city of Binghamton. In addition to the grand prize, the winner also receives administrative support to start or grow their business in the city, such as legal counsel and accounting services donated in kind by Binghamton businesses and organizations. Now in its 14th year, the Binghamton Business Plan Competition is the longest-running competition of its kind in the greater Binghamton area. It aims to cultivate local business development, promote entrepreneurial spirit, and raise awareness about BLDC financing. SUNY Broome's Entrepreneurial Assistant Program and other community resources for small business growth. Second and third place winners receive $2,000 and $500, and the remaining finalists receive gift certificates. Applicants are encouraged to complete business startup or management training through the SUNY Broome EAC or attend the online business development workshop offered March 25th through 27th through the City Office of Economic Development. Applications are due on April 3rd. The federal judge who oversaw a defamation trial that resulted in an $83.3 million award to a longtime magazine columnist who says Donald Trump raped her in the 1990s is refusing to relieve the ex-president from the verdict's financial pinch. Judge Lewis Kaplan told Trump's attorney Thursday that he won't delay deadlines for posting a bond to ensure 80-year-old writer E. Jean Carroll can be paid the award. The judge said any financial harm to Trump's results from his slow response to the late January verdict. He noted that Trump's lawyers waited 25 days to seek to delay posting of a bond for an award that becomes final Monday. That's a look at news. For updates on local news, weather, sports, and features, open up the WNBF app and online at WNBF.com. This is News Radio 1290 WNBF.
I'm Bob Joseph. This is Binghamton Now, the Friday special. March 8th, 2024. Live and local, taking your phone calls with instant gratification at 607-772-1290. Good morning. You're on the air. What's your first name? Where are you calling from?
Hey, Bob. It's Robin Port Crane.
What's up?
Oh, I was watching Joe Biden's speech this morning. Oh, my gosh, that was terrible. Did you watch it?
I watched it live. I didn't want to wait till this morning, so I stayed up late and watched the coverage in its entirety on C-SPAN.
Boy, he looked terrible. He slurred. He stumbled. He coughed all through it. He screamed through half of the thing. He called Lake and Riley Lincoln, you know. This was really, really bad. He blamed the Republicans for the border when he's the one that flew 320,000 of these people in to 43 airports and let 10 million more across the border. You know, it was just crazy. The stuff he was saying was just so nuts. It's elder abuse, Bob. It's really sad. I just can't believe his wife allows this stuff to continue.
Well, I think Dr. Jill Biden is monitoring him carefully. I'm sure she keeps a close watch on him and probably at least once a month has a serious conversation about whether it really is right to continue in his current position or if he wants to sort of, you know, what some people do at a certain age, they sort of go part-time, so maybe she might suggest that he cut back to just working Tuesday through Thursday and then having Kamala Harris take up the, you know, the weekends and Monday and Friday.
God, man, that's a terrible thought.
What do you mean? Vice President is there to help.
Vice President Harris? She's awful.
I don't know. I was watching her reactions during the speech last night, and she found a lot to applaud. She frequently was on her feet cheering on her boss, which, of course, is what you're supposed to do.
I watched her, too, and I watched Joe when he was going blah, 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 and she was just bobbing her head up and down like she understood what he was mumbling. It was pitiful. And it's just, you know, this wasn't even a State of the Union speech. This was a cross between Jeff Dunham's Walter dummy and Weekend at Bernie's. It was just awful. I just can't stand to see our country, you know, be dragged through the mud by this idiot. You know, his whole administration, Bob, it's a diaper fire on top of a dumpster fire.
So what should we do now at this point? Here we are, March 8th, and let's face it, he has another more than 10 months left to get the job done.
Well, I'm glad you asked, what should we do now, Bob? I think it's time for a revolution. I think these people need to go, and they need to hang publicly after they're tried for treason. I've said it before, and nothing's changed.
All right. Well, I have to strongly disagree with your opinion on that, but I, as always, appreciate hearing from you. And that's Rob from Port Crane getting us started on the Friday edition. This is a special Friday edition, so in case you're scoring at home, make a note of that. Put SFE next to the March 8th program. Special Friday edition. SFE. Taking a look at WNBF.com, widely regarded as my favorite website with news and features. Here's a story. I've been keeping an eye on this site on Main Street in Westover, just outside Johnson City, for several years. I am fond of the site because, as a child, I recall they were selling Big Macs at this site. It was a site of the McDonald's store. They had a McDonald's store with Big Macs and Filet-O-Fishes and cheap Shamrock Shakes at this time of year. Well, of course, the McDonald's Corporation could no longer tolerate a Westover location, so eventually it was shut down and then demolished. And for several years, that property at 720 Main Street has been idle. But I did notice with interest 5 or 6 years ago, there was a surveyor on the site, and so I thought, well, this guy will know what's going on. So I stopped and said, hey, what's going on? And he told me, he said, well, they're thinking about building some sort of fast food outlet here. And I said, well, what do you think it'll be? And I said, it used to be a McDonald's. And he said, I don't know. I said, I don't know. The people who hired me to do the surveying work didn't tell me what might happen here. But that was 5 or 6 years ago. And then one thing led to another. And before long, I heard rumors of donuts. At first, I thought it was going to be Krispy Kreme. Then I thought it was going to be Tim Horton. And then I thought it was going to be Spalding Crullers. Well, sorry to disappoint you kids, but it's going to be a Dunkin' coffee shop. So I know a lot of people were hoping it would be the first ever Spalding Cruller stand open 7 days a week, but it won't. So anyway, they have started working there. You can see the story at WNBF.com as a headline says, work resumes on new Dunkin' outlet near Johnson City. So it'll be a Dunkin' outlet, whatever that means. Wouldn't it be funny if they deeply discounted donuts? I think it's going to be regular price donuts. Regular price donuts. And as much coffee as you can afford. So anyway, that's what's going on. A lot of people have come up to me over the last few weeks and said, well, what's going on there? I said, well, I did a story about this last September. And of course, some people will say, oh yeah, I remember that. And then some other people say, I don't know, I must have missed it. So now that they have started work again, I decided to do another story, talk with the people working over there. That's how you find out things. You talk to the people who are actually doing the work. Whatever you do, don't try to talk to the people in charge of, or, you know, the people who are going to open a place. Don't talk to them because they don't like the media. You talk to the people who actually know what's going on. So more details, including the beautiful pictures at WNBF.com. As America runs to Westover, see what they'll be charging for a dozen healthy donuts. 918 at WNBF. Good morning. You're on the air. What's your first name? Where are you calling from?
Scotty from Anytown, USA, Bobby, a.k.a. Golden Gate Boy.
Yeah. How are things over at the Golden I always call it the golden.
We got the golden. We got a couple good days of good weather. It's going to be 64 today and sunny, but the rain comes back tomorrow. So enjoy it while you can, right?
Hey, you do what you can, man. You can't change the weather. Everybody gripes about it, but nobody does a damn thing about
well,
it.
Well, you know, we need the rain, Bobby. We need the rain.
Yeah, that's what I heard. I know some guy who lives in Malibu, and I was talking to him about a week ago, and he said, I think that's exactly what he said. Bobby, we need the rain. And I'm saying, but your mansion, Mel, is on the side of the mountain. How much more rain could you withstand? He said, I don't know. I've got insurance. I don't really care.
He lives in Malibu. Does he know Barbie?
I can't discuss that. I will say, someday when I'm at liberty to talk about my past adventure in Southern California, I'll tell you a little bit about Malibu and Pacific Palisades and the time that I went. No, I was going to say the time I went roller skating on the pier, but no. if I told a tale about roller skating on the pier, people would say, Bob, everything else up to that point we believe, but the part about you roller skating on the pier, well.
Shirtless, with no shirt on, right? And getting all suntan and wearing Tony
yes.
Walkman.
Yeah, wearing my using my $400 pair of former guy skates.
Did you know, I heard something. I had to hear this on Colbert. People aren't going to even get those sneakers until July.
that? You know, that sounds like bait and switch. Sounds like their money. It's like Steve Miller, take the money and run.
You know what? I got another. Well, I'm going to vacillate on many things here, Bobby, and go off on tangents, but. Okay, the former guy has $500 million in fines, right? Or Joe Biden's predecessor. How about that? We'll make you sense.
Yeah, let's call him, you know, a lot of people get tired of hearing about the former guy, so we'll just call him the predecessor.
Joe Biden's predecessor. But, okay, his son-in-law got $2 billion from the Saudi Arabian government. Nobody knows why or how or what he's doing for it. But shouldn't he be given his pops-in-law like $500 million to cover his legal bills?
Yes, absolutely.
Right. So
here's my question, though. Jared Kushner, and there I said it, JK to his friends, just kidding.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
JK, and always look, and of course you don't see him out in public much, but when you do, he has that spit-eating grin. I'm looking at a picture. I mean, go to any computer. Go to your public library, if they'll let you in, and go to a computer and just Google Jared Kushner and take a look at the first picture that shows up. I mean, it looks like if he were just a little bit more honest, he could be a used car salesperson. Just a little bit more. Most used car lots wouldn't accept this guy. Well, you know, we need a part-time guy to come in Saturday mornings because occasionally we have some customers coming in to kick the tires. So, JK, could you come in and maybe, keep an eye on the lot from Saturday from 9 to noon? They wouldn't even want him.
My thing is if the Democrats, and they probably are going to take over Congress again in the 2024 elections, why not just go after him like the Republicans are going after Hunter Biden, right?
I hear your suggestion, and I understand that it's motivated, of course, strictly because you care about America. I personally
love America. God bless America, Bobby.
America, love it or love it
or
more.
Leave it.
No, don't leave it. No, if you're here, stay. And if you're not here, come on in. We got plenty of room. I'm opening up. How about this? Listen to this, Scotty. America. America, the best country ever invented. We love it here. We only have 333 million legal residents, and who knows how many who are not officially documented, but we're working on it. We'll eventually get to them, you know, in the next 10 or 20 years to document. But come on in. How about this? About April Amnesty Month. Anybody, anywhere, with any record, come on into America.
Well,
just for 30 days.
April Fool's, Bobby.
It would be April Fool's.
Oh, man.
Can you imagine what would happen to me if I said that on the air?
Oh, my God. Oh, good.
I mean, there would be.
There would be riled there, up. Coming for you.
Oh, there would be.
Tiki torches outside.
There would be heck to pay.
Now, you know, really quick on last night's speech, Mitt Romney said, hey, Joe Biden had energy and he had voice. I mean, this is going to be a big warning shot to Republicans out there. They were expecting Joe to come in all sleepy and, you know, and then they said, oh, see, he's...
Yeah, but some people said he was on drugs. I saw some of the commentary.
Give me some of those drugs, Bob. Give me some of those drugs.
It's like Huey Lewis said, I want a new one, baby. But
give me that drug.
Oh, man. You know, and I don't know. I watched the whole thing. Here's what I did. I did because I wanted to get the flavor of what many of our listeners would be experiencing. Here's how it went. For the first, inexplicably, for I'd say starting at about 8:45, I turned on CNN News. I don't know why, because nobody watches them anymore. CNN News, they still had a signal. I'm surprised that they still had a signal. So I watched their preliminary coverage, including some of the coverage, because apparently they had some kind of protest or something out on Pennsylvania Avenue. I didn't quite follow. For 20 or 25 minutes, I generally watch the CNN News. And then to experience the State of the Union message, as many of our listeners were, I switched over to Fox Cable. And I got to say, they did a good job. While the president was speaking, I thought Fox Cable did a great job of transmitting the speech, because I don't recall hearing anybody in the anchor booth at Fox Cable interrupting him. So I thought their overall coverage was excellent. And then after it ended, because I didn't want to be told by anyone, Fox, CNN, MSNBC, or anything like that, then I switched over to C-SPAN, because it took him something like 35 minutes to get the heck out of there, because everybody, including Republicans, wanted to get a selfie with him.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And I'm watching on C-SPAN.
Taylor Greene.
Yes. Well, did you see that?
Even
she had some sort of. She had a 4-year-old hat
MAGA
on.
Hat.
Yeah, I mean, she didn't even get. Now, and you know, look.
Yeah, she had a 2020 hat.
Yes. Yeah, I would think, you know, I mean, are things that bad for her that she couldn't spring, you know, for the $40 or $50 to get a 2024 edition hat? And I thought, well, you know, if what she says is true, the economy is bad, and so she probably couldn't spring for the $80 or $90 to get a 2024 edition hat. But I'll tell you what I would have done is at least called the guy, the predecessor, and said, look, I'm going to get some screen time on TV. I have this little devious plan because I'm going to stake out a spot on the aisle. The speech doesn't start till 9, but I'm going to get there at about 6:30 a.m. So I'll have a prime spot, and then I'll be in the camera shot, and all I have is this 4-year-old 2020 edition hat. And then you tell the predecessor, could I just borrow? I don't have the $130 that you're charging for the 2024 hats, but could I just borrow or maybe rent just for 24 hours a 2024 edition? And at least we'll get this photo op of the predecessor 2024 on the back of the hat, and then me glad-handing America's favorite president. That's what if I was one of her advisors, and who is to say I'm not, by the way, notice I've never said I've never gone on record. People would say, oh, Bob, you wouldn't be giving her advice. It'd be like, how do you know? How do you know who I advise?
It couldn't be any worse than anybody who's giving her advice now. That's a darn
exactly.
Sure.
Anyway,
really
so
quick about inflation. I got a quick question on inflation. Do you think Joe Biden's predecessor, with inflation now and the price of food, would be throwing hamburgers against the wall at the White House?
No, he'd be throwing out rolls of paper towels. And people would be like, what does that mean? Well, we were told by the campaign that it's to protest the high price of beef. Well, if that's the case, why didn't he throw packets of beef? I don't know. Somebody said the predecessor's confused, but he is really, really upset about the high price of beef. So he went there with a carton of brawny paper towels, and I don't know. Nobody can draw the correlation, but he sure seems to be having one heck of a time, Brownie.
Well, yeah, you can tell he wasn't a basketball player by throwing out those towels, but I'm just wondering, would he be still whipping hamburgers against the wall at the White House? And they just cleaned up the dang White House now.
Oh, my God.
God forbid he can.
I was going to say, yeah, the hazmat team was there for a long time. It was one of their toughest challenges in D.C., anyway, thank you, Scotty. That's a story from Northern California making contemporary news. 928, this is a very special edition of Binghamton Now. I'm Bob Joseph.
From the Galt Auto Studios, this is WNBF News Radio AM 1290. Also available at 92.1 FM. Save in a big way at Galt Chevrolet.
I'm Bob Joseph. You're listening to Binghamton Now live and local. Living Keller on a Friday morning. Special event coming up later this month at the Shore Family Firehouse Stage in Johnson City. And joining us now to talk about it is Mike Carbone. Good morning, Mike.
Good morning, Bob. Thanks for having me on the show this morning.
Well, thanks for joining us. It's good to chat with you. I know you're looking forward to a very special program coming up on March 18th. Tell our listeners what they can expect.
Well, as part of what's called the Enjoy Jazz Series at the Firehouse Stage, we have on March 18th from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m., a very eclectic but grooving jazz group based out of Syracuse, made up of a father who's a bass player, Matthew Vacante, and his two daughters, Cecilia and Vanessa. Vanessa is a jazz vocalist that lives in Buffalo, and Cecilia is a jazz violinist that lives in Boston. Both have graduated from prestigious music schools. And the group is rounded out by piano player Dave Salazzo and drum set player Joe Cortini. So the two girls are fronting the band and backed up by this trio, also known as Joe Cortini and the Jazz Mafia. It's a fantastic group. The two daughters are just amazing musicians. One's a vocalist, like I said, and the other is a jazz violinist. And they will play an incredible program of fun, you know, toe-tapping and grooving music for those complete 2 hours.
Well, that sounds interesting. I'm just intrigued by the concept of, you know, the father and the two daughters. That part alone sounds intriguing enough to check it out.
Yeah, and we have information about the band on the Firehouse Stage website, which, again, people can also buy tickets there ahead of time, and all tickets are $17 either online or at the door. Firehousestage.org, and from there they can go to events and then click on March 18th or any of the other shows if they're interested. But we do this Enjoy Jazz Series once a month, and we've got groups from now through June, and then we start up again in September through December. Once a month on a Monday night, we're bringing some of the best regional and area jazz musician groups to the Firehouse. We've even, you know, brought some people out of New York City and, you know, Philadelphia, Scranton to perform, you know, supplemented by musicians from the upstate area and our own area. So it's so far been pretty much a sold-out show every time, so we're encouraging people to get tickets online as quickly as possible. And it's a very easy process if they go to firehousestage.org.
And again, the Vacante Sisters Jazz Quintet will be performing at the Shore Family Firehouse Stage a week from Monday. That'll be the evening of March 18th.
Yeah, and for those people who have never been to the firehouse, it's a very comfortable seating. It's a tiered seating. Some of it sort of like looks like a dinner show setup about the dinner. But we do have a bar with beverages and some food items that people can purchase either before the show or during the intermission. And it's a really wonderful setup. The sound and lighting is amazing, and it's very comfortable. And a great view of the band pretty much from any seat in the house. And it's just great music, and the area is really supporting it well. And we just want to get the word out so we bring in some new people to see what's here, because it's not available anywhere else in the area except for the Firehouse stage through the Enjoy Jazz program.
All right, Mike Carbone, thank you for the update. It should be a special program in Johnson City on March 18th, and I know you'll be keeping in touch with us in the coming months to let our listeners know about the additional presentations, especially for jazz enthusiasts around our region.
Yes, and it's, like I said, it's quite a wide range of jazz styles. And one different show that we have coming up on April 21st, which is a Sunday show in the afternoon, is the Cool Club and the Lipker Sisters. It's sort of a modern version of the Andrews Sisters with a lot of new and R&B jazz twisted stuff with these three ladies, all true sisters that do an amazing show as well.
Mike Carbone, thanks for checking in. Hope you have a great weekend. And I know a lot of our listeners will be looking forward to that show on March 18th.
All right. Thanks, Bob. Appreciate the time.
All right.
Hope to see you there.
Okay. I'll try to get over there. I'll try to squeeze it into my extremely busy schedule.
We'll save you a seat.
Thank you. Take care, Mike.
Thanks, Bob.
It's 9:37. We're live and local on News Radio WNBF. I'm Bob Joseph. We'll take more phone calls. Your call could be next, but only if you manage to successfully dial 10 digits. 607. Wait, come here. You. You don't just slither in here.
Which mic would you?
Why don't you take that? Why don't you take that?
Okay.
Tree?
Yeah,
I know you're.
Robert, how are you? Do I need an introduction, or is the voice all that's necessary?
That is all that's necessary. But I think because of FCC rules, we're required. Yes. So hold on a second here.
Okay.
Because
shall I give you my full government?
Yes, actually. So hold on a second.
Yes.
I want to tape this for posterity.
Oh, wonderful.
And I know you also have a crew in here taping things. Hello.
Well, yes.
And you are?
I'm Sam.
Hi, Sam.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Thanks for stopping by our beautiful studio. Don't you think it's cool that it's
cool.
An underground bunker?
Yes, I know.
Seven stories down, B minus seven.
I was going to say.
Wow.
You know, we're insulated from the rest of the world. And
Yes, you're fine, but we are on the air right now.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, so wait, why don't you just get near this microphone? Just to say hi.
Yes.
Hello. Yeah.
So the thing is, people have probably figured out, hold on, let me get my...
Right,
want to get you in frame.
We're videotaping each other with our respective smartphones.
Yes.
How 21st century.
I was going to say, you know... This wouldn't have been possible 10 years ago. Okay. All right.
All right. This is James Merrill Emke, the news director at WIVT WBGH News Channel 34. You can catch me every evening at 6 p.m. and 11 p.m. Thank you, Robert.
On both NBC 5.
Yes. On that's correct. On our ABC channel, which we actually refer to these days as 34.1.
Oh, I didn't even realize. See,
and
I am
NBC station, which is 34.2. But yes, often referred to as NBC 5 because that's where our good friends at Spectrum place us on the cable channels.
Right.
And then our ABC is over on cable channel 6.
Now, don't tell anybody, the new Binghamton Now channel that'll be rolling out on April Fool's Day will be on 34.9. It'll be like all Bob all the time.
Yes, yes. Speaking of that, nice to see that you guys have taken one of your no longer utilized studios and turned it into a crying room. I'm sure many of your guests stop in there on their way out of the studio after you've, you know, given them the ninth degree. with your hard line of questioning.
Well, sometimes it is true. After they've been subjected to some sort of congressional-style interrogation, sometimes they're like, I didn't sign up for this. Come on, man.
Well, what you did seem to sign up for, Bob, is Sam and I bum-rushing the station today. We decided we would storm the studio for one very good reason, and that is I am now on TikTok.
I heard that. By the way, not to burst your bubble.
Yes.
I've been told I have to get on TikTok soon, too. So it's not going to happen right away. But by the end of the month, if the Chinese government permits me, I, too, will be on TikTok, James.
Robert, everyone's doing it. Everyone's doing it. So. All right. What I like to do, I don't always do this, but I do enjoy theming my TikTok weeks. I had a nice week in which we checked out the tunnels of Broome County. We also did a week where we were examining some of the lovely properties that the city is taking over from Mr. Isaac Ansroot as part
of their
settlement.
Oh, you did that already?
Yes, we featured about a half a dozen different very nice, well-kept. Obviously, I'm joking with that. Well-kept.
See, now I am... Yes. You know, it's occurred
to me... You have the release in your hand?
Oh, yeah,
yes.
Because...
Oh, we went down... Now, I'll caution you, some of those properties
are vacant lots. I discovered that, on Henry Street, not far from the stadium. Yep. Oh, Clinton Street. I saw some guy. Yes. He parks his... I don't think I'm allowed to say this. He parks his BMW there with no license plates on that lot on Clinton Street. So I have a guy with a flatbed. So I know what I'm going to be doing tomorrow around noon. And I know, like, Captain Miner is saying, make note of that. If we got a stolen vehicle report from the First Ward, we'll bring two of our best guys down to question Bob on Monday. So you did the thing about, because what I was going to call it was... what was it? The Ansroot Collection. That's what I was going to call it. And see, I already had taken photos of probably about 10 of the lots. And then at one point, I just said, man, there's a lot here. Because there's 26 properties.
It's only scratching the surface because
he
turned over the ones that weren't already in bank foreclosure.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So, one I actually did find on Carey Street that's still occupied. So,
I was there too.
So the city will actually take those folks on as tenants, at least initially. And again, just deplorable conditions.
But, to be fair, And just so everyone knows, in the interest of fairness, I have, as they say in the media, reached out to Isaac Ansroot repeatedly. He used to return my calls, but not so much in the last 4 months. And so I want to get his perspective. Maybe that's going to be the way I advance the story.
Okay.
So you've already done some of the select sites, but I'll advance it and say the Ansroot Collection as seen through the eyes of a Brooklyn native.
There you go. But anyway, I want to move on to what we're doing week. The actual purpose of this storm.
I was going to say, it's too bad we're out of time now, Jim, and you weren't able to explain.
No. Yes. I'm not leaving. I'm mad.
Yes.
No, I'm very happy to
be
here.
Yes, Howard Beale.
Because it's Chicago Teen Edition Week on Jim Emke's TikTok. So, with or without your permission, Bob, we're going to go ahead and record one of our amazing TikToks right here. Are you ready? Sam, are you ready? Okay, here we go. Jim Emke here in the studio with none other than Bob Joseph, our area's leading radio talk show host. Let me tell you, folks, everybody in town is listening to Bob every morning from 9 to noon. Now, as you know, it's Chicago Teen Edition Week on Jim Emke's TikTok, and I have been part of a publicity junket this week, helping to promote the show because, I'll admit, my daughter is the lead, Roxy Hart. She's gonna be fantastic. Now, We've already had a story on News Channel 34. She's been on Channel 12's Around the Tears. But we've yet to talk about this on WNBF News Radio 1290. And WNBF.com, I should mention.
Oh, and 92.1 FM. And
92.1 as well. Let's get with the program.
Oh, here. And the WNBF app.
And the WNBF app. And coming soon, the Bobbo TikTok account is joining as well. Mm-hmm. So, Bob, let me tell you, this show is going to be fantastic. As everybody knows, Binghamton High School has the Rod Serling School of Fine Arts, and they put a lot of effort into these productions. I'm so fortunate that my daughter goes to that school, because from the point she was a freshman, she's a junior now, she could take theater as an elective, dance as an elective, and of course, part of the secret sauce to their productions is not only their fabulous director, Maggie Haynes, previously Maggie Gilroy, yep, was in the biz with us,
professional journalist.
A professional journalist, but also that crazy old man, Larry Cassin.
Oh, I ran into him at Wegmans the other night. And in fact, he was supposed to get back to me, I think, to promote this thing. I said, Larry, you have something coming up? And he said, you know, Bob, we do. And I haven't heard back from him.
We talked about that yesterday, and he was lamenting. Oh. He is so hardworking, has so much on his plate. So I said, never fear, Larry. I'm there for you. Tomorrow morning, I am going to storm Bob's studio, and I'm going to let all of Greater Binghamton know about how awesome this production of Chicago Teen Edition is. Contractually obligated, by the way, to call it Chicago Teen Edition.
Yes.
Because we don't want to otherwise be luring all of the people who would be going to see the Broadway Chicago in Manhattan up here to Binghamton to see our superior performance.
Exactly.
You know.
So anyway, advertising.
Tickets are all sold at the door, 7:30 Friday, that's tonight, 7:30 Saturday, that's tomorrow, and 2 o'clock matinee on Sunday. Tickets are very reasonable, $8, $6 for students and seniors, and it's all general admission. Box office opens an hour before the show. Doors open half an hour before. I expect there's going to be a line. We've got family and friends coming from far and wide, flying up from North Carolina, driving down from Rochester. We're going to fill the balcony. Folks, you want to be there. This is a great show.
Excellent.
Oh, and see me at 6 and 11.
I was going to say, you must watch Jim Emke and, of course, all your colleagues at News Channel 34, Monday through Friday at 6 and 11 p.m. Be informed. America needs more well-informed citizens.
Thank you, Bob. Thank you so much. All right, now I guess I will go and find the staircase back up, since we're not allowed to take the elevator back up to the ground floor.
Jim Emke, that sadly is true. You know, we lure people down. It's like, come on down. It's so easy. It's sort of like a cable or newspaper subscription. Here, sign up here, and you can come in, and it's so easy. And then we interview you, and then you say, oh, good, I can take the elevator back. And I said, oh, no. You take the hard way. In fact, you may be stuck here. It's sort of like one of those subscriptions where you can never cancel. Or one of those hotels like in California where you can't really check out.
I know.
Jim Emke, again, from News Channel 34. Check out Jim and all his colleagues for the very best news and information in the world.
Oh, thank you.
Monday through Friday, 6 and 11 p.m.
Thank you so much.
And thank you, James.
All right,
and
we'll be.
And again, you?
I'm Sam. Thank you.
Thank you for coming in. It's been so much fun. That's why this is a special Friday edition of Binghamton Now on WNBF. There on the video, I had to look serious. I had to channel my inner Walter Cronkite to give the illusion I could be the most trusted person on Court Street. Thank you so much.
All right, well, thank you.
Live and local. Hey, who knows what's going to happen in the next couple of hours? I have no idea, and that's why they allow me to be on WNBF. Here is the news. Or as they would say in Australia, here are the news. It's 9:54 WNBF and all of our affiliated stations down the line. Sorry, they also make me document when people come in unannounced and uninvited. Let's see, Jim Emke, News Channel 34. It's not a big thing. They just want it documented, you know. You know, corporate. Who came into the studio there without a formal invitation? Oh, it's Mr. Emke. It's okay. Thank you, Mr. Emke. Oh, I know what would be nice. They do this on the radio and a lot of times on TV. The weather from the National Weather Service. Mostly sunny today. High 57. Increasing clouds tonight. Low 37. Tomorrow cloudy. Rain in the afternoon. High 46. Sunday, this looks like a beaut. Mostly cloudy. Rain and snow showers in the morning. Then snow showers late in the day. High 41. Right now, it's 35 in downtown Binghamton here at News Radio, WNBF. And what is that Celsius? I guess that's one Celsius. One-ish, two-ish. And air quality index is not available. But I was out less than an hour ago, and the air seemed pretty good by Binghamton standards. Coming up, more of your phone calls and more of who knows what on a special Friday edition, SFE, Binghamton Now with Bob Joseph on News Radio, WNBF and WNBF.com.
WNBF. Where news breaks first. News Radio 1290 WNBF.
This is News Radio 1290 WNBF News. For today, mostly sunny skies, high near 57. Increasing clouds tonight, low around 37. For the weekend, cloudy Saturday with rain in the afternoon, high near 46. Sunday, rain possibly mixed with snow showers, high near 41. Donald Trump will be allowed to know the names of jurors in his upcoming New York hush money criminal trial. The public will not. Manhattan Judge Juan Merchant ruled Thursday to keep the yet-to-be-picked jury anonymous, with limited exceptions for the former president, his defense lawyers, prosecutors, jury consultants, and legal staffs. Only Trump's lawyers and prosecutors will be allowed to know the addresses of the jurors' homes and workplaces. Trump could risk forfeiting access to the names if he were to disclose them publicly. Jury selection is slated to begin March 25th. The First Ward Action Council announced that they are now accepting applications for the new Vestal Chateau Apartments on Route 26 in Vestal. The complex will offer 30 units consisting of 20 one-bedroom and 10 two-bedroom apartments designed for affordable senior housing. Monthly rent will range from $529 to $768, including heat, water, and sewer expenses. Amenities in each unit include modern kitchen and bath spaces, energy-efficient heating, stability, hearing, and visual impairments. 7 units are tailored for mobility-impaired individuals, 2 for those with hearing and vision impairments, and 5 for frail elderly seniors. All ground floor units are adaptable for wheelchair accessibility. The deadline for all applications is March 29th. Fear of crime on subways and buses in New York City is back as a top concern in some other cities as well, and so are the efforts aimed at persuading the public that officials are taking the issue seriously. New York State Governor Kathy Hochul plans to deploy 750 members of the National Guard to help patrol the nation's busiest subway system. In Pennsylvania, lawmakers have created a special prosecutor to go after crimes committed in the transit system that serves the southeast of the state. Philadelphia's mayor has also promised to beef up police patrols and use every legal and constitutional tool at her disposal. Hochul acknowledged that calling in the National Guard was as much about soothing fears and making a political statement as it was about making mass transit safer. A Conklin man is facing multiple felony drug charges following a traffic stop in the city of Binghamton. On March 3rd, Broome County Sheriff's deputies performed a traffic stop on Shenango Street in Binghamton. The driver, James Bell Jr. of Conklin, was found to be in possession of 21.7 grams of a substance that field tested positive for meth along with a scale. Bell was arrested and charged with two counts of criminal possession of a controlled substance in the third degree and criminal use of drug paraphernalia in the second degree. While in custody, he was found to have concealed on his person an additional 2.7 grams of a substance that field tested positive for meth. Bell was additionally charged with tampering with physical evidence, a Class C felony. He was arraigned and currently remains in custody. Bell had previously been arrested on February 23rd on two counts of criminal possession of a controlled substance in the seventh degree following a traffic stop in the town of Union and released on an appearance ticket. Construction of a new Dunkin' Donut and coffee shop in the town of Union is moving forward after a delay of several months. Work at the site in Westover started late last summer. Some excavation operations occurred at the property at the intersection of Main Street and Oakdale Road. The Dunkin's shop was expected to be built by the end of November, but construction was halted. Workers with TRW Construction of Elmira recently returned to the site just west of Johnson City. There's been plenty of activity in the property over the past couple of weeks. BAPA Network of Horseheads plans to operate the Dunkin' store. The actual construction of the 1,700-square-foot shop is expected to be completed in April. The parking lot then will be paved and stripped. Authorities in Pennsylvania say a woman was seriously injured in a bear attack when she left her dog outside. State Game Commission workers then killed the mother bear and tranquilized her three yearling cubs so that they can be moved into the wilderness. Butler Township Police said the 55-year-old woman was taken to a hospital and then another for treatment of injuries to her arm, face, neck, and head. The woman's neighbors say they've been seeing bears for weeks and that a doorbell camera recorded four bears rummaging through trash cans. That's a look at news. For updates on local news, weather, sports, and features, open up the WNBF app and online at WNBF.com. This is News Radio 1290 WNBF.
WNBF. I'm Bob Joseph. You're listening to a special Friday edition of Binghamton Now. Totally live, totally unscripted, with no agenda, just your phone calls, 607-772-1290.
There's a little black spot on the sun today. It's the same old thing as yesterday. There's a black hat caught in a high tree top. The flagpole rack and the wind pulls stop.
What does this all mean, anyway? What is their point?
I have stood here before, inside the pouring rain, with the world turning circles, running round my brain. I guess I'm always hoping that you'll end this rain, but it's my destiny to be the king of rain.
All right, well, it'd be ahead if Taylor Swift released it. 10-10. If I was in New York on the radio, I could say 10-10 wins, but I'm in Binghamton, so I'll just say it's 10-10 at WNBF, 92.1 FM, 1290 AM. Bob Joseph, reporting for duty. I'll be here till noon today, unless operational requirements suggest otherwise. Just posted a clip, about a two-minute clip, of the impromptu visit by Jim Emke from News Channel 34. So if you check it out on the Elon Musk platform called Twitter, you'll see a little bit of what was going on during that Friday morning surprise with that visit by James Emke, who has managed to make journalism great again. So take a look at that, and you can see for yourself what it's all about. And then, as he suggested, the real reason for his popping in was to do a little thing for his TikTok. So I'm sure that'll be appearing soon. So that's great. So always, always a pleasure to welcome Jim Emke to Binghamton Now here at WNBF. It's 10:12. Let's take a phone call. Hi, WNBF. You're on the air. What's going on?
There's a little red sore on your lip today.
I came so close to just bleeping the heck out of that. Anyway, good morning, DJ from Binghamton.
No, that's a happy song. It's a fan.
Well, I know it's a happy song. I just didn't like your rendition of it. No, it's fine when Stang does it, but you know, maybe it's just you're using a bad phone. Maybe you're using one of those Obama phones.
Well, you know why they call them Sting, don't you? Because, yeah. Anyway, no, I'm using my regular phone, and I am having a great weekend thus far. How about you, Bob?
Where are you broadcasting from? The Holland Tunnel? What the heck is going on? I mean, so either you're in a wind tunnel with David Martin trying to prove what it looks like when winds of 192 miles an hour are blown at you, or else you're in the Holland Tunnel stuck in traffic. What's going on?
Well, I have a 5G phone. Is this better? I'm holding it up closer.
Oh, yeah, that's a lot better. So anyway, what's on your mind? What's going
on,
man?
I'm holding it closer for my brother from another mother. Well, it's the weekend. Today is March 8th. It's new beginnings. So I'm starting a new beginning in my life, something I haven't done in 19 years, as they say in Rio Linden. And so, yeah, I'll tell you about it maybe Monday or Tuesday.
All right. Well, all I can say is you better be careful out there.
Well, it's an excursion that I have done a couple times before in my life as I'm a very adventurous person, and you know me.
I know. You're going to Bethlehem, Pennsylvania, to see the place where they make the Peeps.
I lived a very blessed life in my roaring 20s, and I'm living a very blessed life now in my 40s. So, yeah. And, yeah, the hair's not gray, Bob. So that's cool. What are you doing this weekend? What's going on? What's going on in the Binghamton area?
Well, I have a full lineup planned for this weekend. I'm certainly not going to broadcast it. Last thing I want is people saying, "Oh, well, Bob said he's going to be here on Saturday night, so let's go over there." And it's like, I mean, it could work either way. If I say I'm going to be such and such place on State Street, then people say, "Oh, let's go over there. Maybe we could talk to Bob when he's off the air." Or it could be just the opposite. Ew, Bob said he's going to be there. We were going to go, but I don't want to be in a place that would let Bob in. So, yeah, I usually don't provide advance publicity of exactly where I'll be in downtown Binghamton. All I'm going to say is keep a close watch out at some of the hottest spots.
Watch on this heart of mine.
All right.
So far I heard about Carbone and his trombone, and he's going to be in there broing Zeddy's pizza. And then I heard about Russ the big guy every second Friday.
Yeah. So, yeah, actually, yeah, the thing that Russ the big guy was talking about, that's going on tonight in Endicott. So I'm not saying I'm going to be there, but I will say this. When he was talking about it on the program yesterday, it sounded fascinating. So let's just put it this way. I wouldn't rule it out. What were you about to say about Mr. Emke?
Oh, Mr. Emke, yeah, he was on. Yeah, that was a great vocal show he put on there, and he talked about his daughter, his little Miss Hart, I guess his daughter. He's a great guy, man. He grew up around the area like moi. So me and Jim Emke are both German. His last name's Emke. And you know I'm a Skribsatz. I say it like a German so people can't spell it. And Remember when he interviewed me for the Fainting Club when we met at Endwell Church of Christ? We had a blast.
Well, they told me that because of all the publicity that you gave it, they had like 50% more inquiries than they expected. They told me, don't tell DJ, but thanks to his publicizing it, and that, you know, the Satan Club was there at Homer Brink School. And suddenly they're saying, like, well, we were going to buy like $50,000 worth of advertising. It turns out we don't need that because we've got people like DJ who are calling our bluff and giving us free publicity. And I said, yeah, well, it's the way it works in every town you go. And they said, yeah, pretty much.
Well, they canceled the day that I preached on the lawn of Homer Brink, but you know what? They ended up getting it in with the Broome County Library.
So and I commend them. You know, I commend them for finding a venue. Actually, it's probably more convenient for people in the Triple Cities at the library instead of over off Hooper Road in Endwell.
Well, so far I like the best. I like Russ. What's his name? Russ, the big guy. Yeah. He did a caricature of me when I was at the Tioga County Fair. Remember when I had the long hair? I rode one of my three motorcycles. He did a caricature of me, Russ the Big Guy. I think that's what he called himself.
Yeah, no, I saw it on the FBI website. You're right.
I've been on there a few times.
Well, yeah, but fortunately, you're no longer in the top 10, as Casey Kasem would say. Dropping out of the top 40, DJ from Binghamton, bubbling under now at 44, America's Most Wanted, as Casey's Coast to Coast continues. Anyway, hope you have a great weekend.
Bob, I no longer take my compound bow in the banks anymore. I leave it at home, so we're good.
Thank you. It's 10:18 at WNBF. Well, we do know how to have fun here, don't we? 607-772-1290. Come on. You can call in to join the WNBF Morning Zoo with Bob Joseph and the other animals on Binghamton Now.
From the Galt Auto Studios, this is WNBF News Radio AM 1290. Also available at 92.1 FM. Shop Toyota, Chevy, BMW, and pre-owned at galtauto.com.
First News Binghamton.
Morning Zoo, WNBF. Yes, with those dancing monkeys. I know you're saying, but Bob.
Never seen anybody do the things you do before.
That's all fine, but where are the dancing giraffes? And we'll have an announcement about the dancing giraffes coming up this spring. The only station that brings you dancing giraffes and one dance monkey. All right, let's hit the phones again, if we must. Vinny from Binghamton, good morning. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning, Bob. I just wanted to call in and tell you about how I love Joe Biden. Boy, he hit it out of the park.
Why don't you give me three reasons why anyone should love the guy?
Three reasons? Because last night, well, first of all, we all doubted him. Okay, the media's been, oh, he doesn't know this. He can't put two sentences together. Oh, he can't. Well, he knocked out of the park. I like that part. I love the aggressiveness. I love because that's how you have to go after Donald Trump. You can't be all really presidential. You can't be all uptight and proper. No, you got to be right down on the ground, man, and pop this guy once in a while. Just keep jabbing. That's the second part. And I just love, let him be himself, because he is. Just let Joe be himself. And that's what he was. You know, I just loved when he talked about He said, what was that? Oh, you can't love your country only when you win. Oh, I love that. I love that part when he said that. And then he went after. Now, Bob, I don't know if you saw this part, but there's a part where he's standing. The Supreme Court is down to his right. And he looks at him and he tells him about the Roe versus Wade. He said, all due respect. And he talked about the power of women. And you're soon going to find out. Oh, my God, the women. Oh, they went crazy. I just loved it. Everything he talked about. And then he went and talked about the thing he's doing. You know, he had Marjorie Greene there. I think she thought it was a CPAC meeting because she had a hat on.
Oh, it was funny. Well, I mean, funny and sad simultaneously because everybody else, for the most part, there were a couple of other notable exceptions. But I mean, even George Santos showed up dressed, at least the top half of Santos looked okay as far as the bottom half, including the shoes. But I'm no fashionista. I'll just say, even Santos, at least 50%, including the, what was that, the sequined neckline or whatever. I don't know. It was pure Santos right out of Central Casting. But I got to say, with Marjorie, and I can call her Marjorie because she does work for me technically as a government employee, even though she doesn't represent my district here in upstate New York. But Marjorie didn't seem to know what the dress code was. First, it's well known in the chamber, no hats. No hats. Mm-hmm. And there she is. And again, I made this observation earlier, and I understand she feels strongly about the predecessor. Many people do. Hey, the predecessor. I'll give him credit. He definitely preceded the current president. But, you know, to go in with a hat that was probably at least 4, maybe 5 years old, touting the guy's initial run when he actually managed to be a winner for once, you know, that's one thing. But why didn't she spring, you know, pay the $199 or $299, whatever, maybe $499, whatever, $500 for the new hat, the 2024 model? That would have looked so much better during that 15 milliseconds of fame she had on C-SPAN, where you could see her wearing her red and white hat talking with the leader of the free world. I mean, that would have been money well spent, even if she had to put it on the card. $500 or $600 for a 2024 model hat. Hey, I would have almost considered fronting her the money just for the look.
Well, you know, I thought what also what State of the Union address is, it's when the president speaks to the people. You know, the cabinet, they, you know, they're out there. But
Vinny, he turned it into some sort of political campaign speech. I got to tell you, the guy seemed really angry most of it.
Well, he was. You know why, Bob? Because he showed. I said, did you see people? Why is the Republican Party sitting down when we're talking about raising the minimum wage? Everything that they were. See, this is what I've always said about, because they always talk about the Democrats. How can we reach the rural people that feel like they've been left behind? And I'll say it. Politicians probably won't say it. They'll get around, you know, they'll say certain things. And I understand that. But the straight in your face answer is because you guys stop listening. We told you about education. We tell you about good paying jobs. We tell about health care. The Democratic Party's base, their basics has never changed. It's always been the same. You saw that last night. Did you see those guys when he talked about the border and that camera went to Langford, that congressman from was Oklahoma, I think it is? He goes, that was a Republican bill. Boy, he looked like he wanted to shoot somebody. You could tell he was so ticked. My own party cut my throat. And we had a very, very, and Biden was telling him, I had to drag. You see these Democrats on the other side? I had to drag them to get this bill. Schumer, same thing. I had to drag these guys. And we went to bill, and you guys kill it. You guys kill it. And it was beautiful. They're all so boo, boo, but no. You got. I want the American people watching this to see. Talk about the borders. You killed it. We had a great bill. We had a conservative bill. We had a Republican bill, and you guys still turned it down. And then you turn around and ask me, how am I going to bring people together? Our country is split right there. That's why. None of this whitewashing, none of this diversions. That is why this country is split. They
can't even agree among themselves.
Well, but you could argue the Democrats can't even agree among themselves either. Look, there was some kind of a protest that was staged on Pennsylvania Avenue, and trust me, a lot of the people at the protest probably were registered Democrats, and they were there to show their displeasure with President Biden's approach to what's going on now with the war and not doing more to help the people in Gaza.
Well, you're lucky that the other guy's not in there, because he'd tell you to shut up, and I don't care. It's not our war. He'd be a Mr. Isolationist. And you know one other thing? Can I say this real quick, too, Bob? It's so funny. There's a tape out with our Molinaro talking about the people in my area don't care who the Speaker of the House is. Funny. When Anthony Brandisi was running, do you remember the people calling in here talking about...
They were so against Nancy Pelosi. And
her
aunt. By the way, Vinny... Even more, her husband, for some reason. I'm like, does anybody question any other congressional leader about their spouse? Does anybody say, you know, I don't like Chuck Schumer because of his wife or his girlfriend or what? I don't even know what his situation is, or his wife and girlfriends or whatever. We don't know because nobody cares. So why was everybody so flipped out with Nancy Pelosi, expensive ice cream, and for some reason, her husband, who's being attacked at their home? I don't get it.
Yep.
What was that about, Vinny? You explain that to me.
That's the Republican Party. They move that goalpost any single, because it's not about getting something done right now. It's about power. That's all it is. It's all about power.
That's all it is, I appreciate your call, and stay tuned, because this is going to be a really interesting show. Not that the first half hasn't been really interesting. The first half has been very interesting, but somebody told me, nobody told me, I have this feeling. It's just, you know how sometimes you get a feeling about something? I have a feeling the second half of the show is also going to be interesting. I don't know how. And I don't even know why that we put on 3 hours of interesting material on Friday. You would think by Friday, I would just basically phone it in, either literally or figuratively. I know some people who only work 3 days a week. Imagine that. You're able-bodied, you're sound of mind, you're in great health, and you work 3 days a week? By the way, I'm not criticizing. I'm envious. And where do I sign up for that? Where can I, Bob Joseph, sign up a new contract at WNBF that allows me to host the show Tuesday through Friday and do some reporting around the area and then have four-day weekends for the rest of my life? Where do I sign? I'm kidding. I'm kidding. 607-772-1290. Love to talk to you, whether you want to talk about presidential politics or Kathy Hochul or potholes in Binghamton. Whatever. It's your show. Give me a call. 92.1 FM, 1290 AM, streaming at WNBF.com. Respect Radio. WNBF Live.
Respect yourself. Respect yourself.
And respect America.
Respect yourself.
Back to the phones we go. Matt in Binghamton, you're on the air.
I have to admit, you have the best bumper music in the world. Pop Staples and the Staple Singers, one of the great, great acts of all time.
But and anyway. Wonderful Mavis.
And Mavis.
And you know what I didn't realize, Matthew? Mavis is still with us.
Yeah, she's actually playing in that. There's a big thing that's being put on all the Dylan and Willie Nelson and Mavis and all these people are putting on. Oh, no, actually, Mavis is playing with. I got it mixed up. There's also a Norah Jones concert in Canandaigua, I think it is, where Mavis is playing with her. I saw she actually played. The reason I named my dog after that is I saw her at the Anderson Center quite a few years ago, probably 6 or 7 years ago, and she was amazing. Still amazing.
Well, I missed that.
Bob Dylan at one time wanted to marry her, but never got around to it.
Well, yeah, that's his loss. But I'll say this, and thank you for mentioning that first until I just looked it up. I wasn't positive. I hadn't heard really much in the last couple of years about Mavis Staples. And now that you mention it, I see that they will have a special all-star birthday concert for her in Los Angeles next month. So that, it's going to be April 18th. And listen to the lineup. Listen to some of the people who will be there. Jackson Brown, Norah Jones, Black Pumas, right. Grace Potter, Michael McDonald, Keb Moe, Nathaniel Rateliff, Robert Randolph, Taj Mahal, and Chris Stapleton. Those are just some of the people who will be celebrating with Mavis Staples in just over a month in Los Angeles. I want to go.
Yeah, let's go. Let's do it.
Yeah, it's going to be
maybe our listeners will support it. We'll have a raffle and to support our trip, 50-50 raffle to support our trip to Los Angeles.
How about this? GoFundMe.
Yeah, whatever.
I mean, it would be legal because we would stipulate right up front. It's not like it's for some sort of good cause, but we would stipulate this is a GoFundMe. So Matt from Binghamton and Bob from Binghamton, Vic from the Forks, and Jared from Binghamton, we could all fly out on a private jet, and we could go on April 18th to YouTube Theater to see the All-Star Birthday Concert with Mavis Staples. And, of course, we would stay only at the Beverly Hills place where all the elite hang out.
I see what you did there. You included some people from the other side of the aisle, so it wouldn't look like we're friends, which we're not.
Well, and that was the whole point, because I know if I said, oh, it would be just, GoFundMe for Bob and Matt to go out to Los Angeles on some sort of junket to see the Mavis Staples birthday bash. But if I include Vic from the Forks, no, Rob from Port Crane, there you go.
Oh, yeah. We'll have a revolution
yes,
on the way out.
Yes, why not? The truth is, and again, I don't know the musical taste of the others, but truth is, if we put aside, if only for 2 or 3 days, politics, we could probably all still have a good time. I mean, look, I have video of you and Vic from the Forks actually hanging out up at Davies, and everything was pleasant. Yeah. So if somebody had told me several years ago, oh, Bob, in 2023, you'll be over at Davies with Jim Emke, and you'll have cameras rolling, and Matt from Binghamton and Vic from the Forks will be there, and everything will be fine. I'll be like, what are you smoking, man? You know, call Kathy Hochul. Exactly. Because that's the good stuff.
See, and that's what Democrats are capable of doing. Now, we'll go back into why I call.
Yeah. It.
But I think you're right. I always tell people think I'm really one-sided. I think both sides, since 1980, both sides of the government, whoever's been in president until Joe Biden, actually, and well, somewhat Barack Obama and then Joe Biden, have not cared about the middle class. And somehow they believe that Donald Trump's the populist that cares about them. He doesn't give a damn about them. And it's proven by how he treated all the workers that ever worked for him. Throws them under the bus if they don't agree with him. Doesn't pay them for building his casinos and buildings. has thousands of lawsuits against them. And somehow this is the guy that the forgotten people in America love. I just don't get it. That's what's so hard for so many of me and my friends that look at it and go, why does he have such a hold on these people? But anyway, and the other guy, the other day, somebody said, I look down on people. I think you gave me a clip and I said, right. You know that I am like, look, I was a carpenter before I went to law school. I did work with racehorses. I did a lot of things. I've seen both sides. I know how hard it is to, you know, to make a living, how the unions were destroyed, how they kept wages low for so long. We finally have a president and finally have people that are addressing that. You don't see Republicans addressing minimum wage. There's still a $7 minimum wage for federal workers. It's insane. Now, I'm not saying many get, but contractors and stuff who work for the federal government, they get paid very little because of that. We need people like Joe Biden who cares about building our society from the top, you know, the top up and the middle or middle out or however he says that. And last night, just real quickly, you just said three reasons why I like Joe Biden. He cares about working class people. He wants to build America, not tear it down. That's you can see that in the infrastructure bill, which he was brilliant again of like saying not one Republican voted for it, but they're all out there when the money comes around to their communities, making it like they brought the money to their communities. Total, you know, and then manufacturing jobs, the CHIPS Act, all the over 800,000 and counting, as he said, manufacturing jobs coming back to the United States in an industry that's so important for our security. What happened during the pandemic proved that we need to make those chips in America, because when half the problem with the pandemic and the car industry and all sorts of industries was that they didn't have the components to build. So inflation went way up. A lot of things happened. But this guy, we are the envy of the world right now, our economy. And you can't deny it. The stock market's at all-time highs. And Sean Hannity was beside himself saying that Joe Biden was angry and this and that. Well, if you're not angry with what's going on in this country and the vitriol of Donald Trump and the fact that he's talking, he's not even hiding it. He says he's going to invoke the Insurrection Act. And then that guy from if he ever says what he said, gets in there again and says what he said again on January 6th, if people start protesting him, we will all be locked up, all the protesters, just for expressing our ideas. That's what Donald Trump is going to do in America. He said it. He's telling us.
Well, you know, but maybe being devil's advocate, maybe he's just lying again.
Well, I mean, look,
you said, I think, wasn't it you who called in and said, was it the Washington Post? Some news organization had documented something over 100 lies that he told during the presidency. So what if the thing about locking up people who are against him, if he becomes president again, what if that's just a lie?
No, it was 30,000. So you believe...
What, 30,000? I thought it was about 100.
No, it's over 30,000 lies documented. So here's a guy who really pretty much lies every time he talks. And he's got people, he repeats the lies so often that people who only listen to a certain echo chamber believe that they're true. Oh, and the other part about last night was this up-and-coming star, Senator Katie Britt from, I think she's down south someplace. She even actually said, I mean, I don't know how stupid they are, but she talked about her favorite room, and she broadcast her speech from her kitchen and talked about how, you know, almost said like women should be in the kitchen, which, by the way, is...
Wait, I didn't see that. I was too busy watching C-SPAN because C-SPAN kept the camera and the mic on Joe Biden. I was waiting for them to, broadcast Joe Biden making a gaffe as he headed out of the chamber, because it took well over 30 minutes for him to get through the crowd, because all of the Democrats and Republican fans wanted to talk with him or take a selfie with him. And I thought, well, I'm going to listen carefully on C-SPAN because we'll be able to hear something like where Joe Biden says, yeah, whatever I said about Snickers. What I actually meant is I hope they make the Snicker bars even smaller. And he didn't do it. I didn't hear anything he said in his interactions with several dozen people, maybe more, on his way out after the speech. I didn't hear anything he said that would even constitute a gaffe. You can bet that it was me and the New York Post listening intently to try to find one gaffe as he headed out of the chamber after his speech, and I heard nothing like that.
Well, the difference is Joe Biden has been up against all odds. Look at how divided our country is, and look what he's produced with all the things I just mentioned. All these things are making our economy the best in the world right now. China is in shambles right now. People are leaving China, coming in through our southern border because economic conditions are so bad there. Right now, everybody wants to come here, and that's because we're successful. And then when we have finally Joe Biden in a bipartisan manner gives up a lot of the principles that the Democrats, the radical Democrats, have been saying about the border and says, okay, you're right. It's getting out of hand. It wasn't as bad when me and Barack were in there. We had some all-time lows. And right now, all across the world, though, there's resurgent. I mean, there's this problem. So he looks at it. He gets a group together to work with the Republicans, puts together a bill that they are holding hijacked. Money to Ukraine, to Israel, and to Taiwan as well. And they said, we won't do it, those bills, unless we get a border bill, just to remind people so they don't forget, because these people forget everything that happened in a minute. And basically, you saw what Langford said last night when he talked about the border bill. He goes, he mouthed the words, it's all true.
Yeah, well, I felt badly for that guy. I felt badly for the situation that his colleagues actually put him in. You know, it just seemed to me that he deserved better.
It was Donald Trump who put them in that position.
Oh, I know. It was well documented. I know, but let's face it, there are too many people in the House who are afraid not to comply.
The reality is it's only a handful of people.
Well, that's too many, though. Yes, I didn't say the majority, but yeah, it's enough to gum up the works.
But if those bills, look at what they passed. There was one bill that just recently, I forget, the aid bill to taking out the border bill, aid to Ukraine, and it passed like 79 to something. But now the House won't pass it for just having a clean bill with aid for Ukraine, Israel, and Taiwan. The House, it's really that's why I say it's such a minority. The House is ruled because Mike Johnson's scared about his job.
As he should be. I mean, he's one vote away from losing his leadership position. And so, how sad is that the Republicans, no matter who is the speaker now, the Republican speaker, because of the way it's set up, is always going to be petrified that he or she is going to lose the job.
And who are they petrified of? Donald Trump.
Of course they are.
And that's the only reason. And
because he's the all-powerful. He is the leader of the party. The voters have spoken. He is the Republican leader in America.
And that is why we've got nothing done for the do-nothing Congress, because of exactly that, because he doesn't want to have anything good happen, any solutions to problems, because otherwise it will defray from his continence and how he thinks he can fix everything.
All right. Well, we'll see what happens. Appreciate your call. Hope you have a good weekend. Tell your puppy I said hi. Thank you.
Okay, let's start that.
The GoFundMe.
Fundraising.
All right. Actually, Scotty from the Bay Area said, Bobby, no need for a GoFundMe. Sell $400 sneakers. Spray paint them blue. So that's what we'll do. Hey. Yeah, if you can't beat them, join them. Thank you, Matthew. Yeah. Scrap the GoFundMe. I'm ordering I'm ordering from my sneaker supplier at a cost of probably about $8 a pair. I'm going to order 100 pairs of sneakers, and I'm going to have my supplier, the same one who painted those other sneakers gold or whatever, the sneakers I'll be selling for $400 will be blue. And that way we'll have plenty of money to be able to fly out for the big concert next month in Los Angeles with Mavis Staples and her friends. It's 10:51. This is Bob Joseph, the guy with all the great ideas on WNBF. N54 WNBF Live. Jerry in Apalachin, you're on the air.
Good morning, Bob. Before we start, I just talk very conservative, and I listening to like the last person that was on, I only caught the tail end of it. But I watched the presentation last night, and I think it was well scripted, well written. I think the president read it very, very well. I don't think that he had any part in putting it together. I don't see how people can listen to a speech like that, which is just words, not all of it true. The number of jobs that have been created, all of those numbers are phony numbers. You can look at them, you can make them go up, you can make them go down. Any way you want to present them, you can get across what you want. But to look at today's environment and today's living conditions under this administration and compare it to what we had for up to 8 years ago, I don't know how anyone can support this administration. I mean, today's living conditions, cost of living, cost of food, everything is almost, it's just not bearable anymore.
Oh, I hear you. I can't afford anything. I mean, I went and tried to buy a chicken sandwich yesterday, and the price was, I mean, I bought it, don't get me wrong, because I was hungry, but still, the price was through the roof. So I hear you, man. These prices are just, it's unacceptable, and they keep going up. So I hear you. I'm not going to blame any particular person. I think we have a lot of problems with supply and demand still. It's 10:56. More coming up on WNBF.
This is News Radio 1290 AM, WNBF Binghamton. Now on 92.1 FM, W221 EJ Binghamton, a Town Square media station.
Where news breaks first. News Radio 1290 WNBF.
This is News Radio 1290 WNBF News. Mostly sunny for today, high near 57. Increasing clouds tonight, low around 37. Rain is Saturday afternoon, high near 46. Sunday rain, possibly mixed with snow showers, high near 41. The First Ward Action Council announced they are now accepting applications for the new Vestal Chateau Apartments at 2040 Route 26 in Vestal. The complex will offer 30 units consisting of 20 one-bedroom and 10 two-bedroom apartments designed for affordable senior housing. Monthly rent will range from $529 to $768, including heat, water, and sewer expenses. Amenities in each unit include modern kitchen and bath spaces, energy-efficient heating systems, and accessibility features for individuals with mobility, hearing, and visual impairments. 7 units are tailored for mobility-impaired individuals, 2 for those with hearing and vision impairments, and 5 for frail elderly seniors. All ground floor units are adaptable for wheelchair accessibility. The deadline for all applications is March 29th. A lottery will be held on April 12th at the First Ward Action Council. The Vestal Chateau apartment complex is expected to be completed in late April. Interested individuals can contact the First Ward Action Council for more information and an application. According to the Broome County Sheriff's Office, on February 14th, The Crimes Investigations Unit, along with K-9 Marley, were conducting a search of female-occupied K-dorm. Marley alerted investigators to the presence of narcotics at one of the bunks assigned to Heather Availers of Owego. A plastic bag containing gray powder tested positive for heroin, and Availers was charged with promoting prison contraband in the first degree and criminal use of drug paraphernalia in the second degree. The second incident occurred in the male-occupied F-pod housing unit, where with the help of K-9 Marley, the CIU conducted a cell search that housed Marvin Green of Binghamton. As investigators arrived to enter Green's cell and conduct a search, he was found flushing his toilet multiple times as investigators entered his cell. Green was uncooperative and struggled with officers while attempting to conceal an item on his person, according to the Broome County Sheriff's Office. Green was charged with promoting prison contraband in the first degree, attempting to conceal, alter, and destroy physical evidence, and obstructing governmental administration in the second degree. Several New York City employees have been arrested for their alleged role in a scheme to steal the identities of homeless shelter residents and defraud a pandemic-era relief program. Manhattan prosecutors brought charges against 18 people, including five employees of the city's Homeless Services Agency. Prosecutors said they abused their positions to access the personal information of homeless shelter residents, which they used to obtain $1.2 million in pandemic unemployment benefits. Employees of the New York Police Department, the MTA, and the U.S. Postal Service were also charged in the scheme. Each of the defendants who were arraigned on Thursday afternoon pleaded not guilty to charges that included grand larceny, conspiracy, and burglary. On Thursday, Mayor Jared Cram of Binghamton announced details of the 2024 Binghamton Business Plan Competition. The annual Binghamton Business Plan Competition awards $5,000 to the individual or team that submits the best plan for developing a business in the city of Binghamton. In addition to the grand prize, the winner also receives administrative support to start or grow their business in the city, such as legal counsel and accounting services donated in kind by Binghamton businesses and organizations. Now in its 14th year, the Binghamton Business Plan Competition is the longest-running competition of its kind in the greater Binghamton area. It aims to cultivate local business development, promote entrepreneurial spirit, and raise awareness about BLDC financing. SUNY Broome's Entrepreneurial Assistant Program and other community resources for small business growth. Second and third place winners receive $2,000 and $500, and the remaining finalists receive gift certificates. Applicants are encouraged to complete business startup or management training through the SUNY Broome EAC or attend the online business development workshop offered March 25th through 27th through the City Office of Economic Development. Applications are due on April 3rd. The federal judge who oversaw a defamation trial that resulted in an $83.3 million award to a longtime magazine columnist who says Donald Trump raped her in the 1990s is refusing to relieve the ex-president from the verdict's financial pinch. Judge Lewis Kaplan told Trump's attorney Thursday that he won't delay deadlines for posting a bond to ensure 80-year-old writer E. Jean Carroll can be paid the award. The judge said any financial harm to Trump's results from his slow response to the late January verdict. He noted that Trump's lawyers waited 25 days to seek to delay posting of a bond for an award that becomes final Monday. That's a look at news. For updates on local news, weather, sports, and features, open up the WNBF app and online at WNBF.com. This is News Radio 1290 WNBF.
Hello, everyone. This is your Action News reporter with all the news that is news across the nation on the scene at the supermarket. There seems to have been some disturbance here. Pardon me, sir. Did you see what happened?
Yeah, I did. I was standing over by the tomatoes, and here he come, running through the pole beans, through the fruits and vegetables, naked as a jaybird. And I hollered over to Ethel. I said, "Don't look, Ethel." And it's too late. She'd already been incensed.
He comes.
Boogie there, boogie there.
There he goes.
Boogie there, boogie there.
And he ain't wearing no clothes.
Well, yes, they call him the street.
Boogie there, boogie there.
Fastest thing on 2 feet.
Boogie there, boogie there.
He's just as proud as he can be.
All right, enough of that, but the whole point is you think we have problems now, and I don't look at them as problems, by the way. I look at them as challenges. So America has challenges, but 50 years ago, we had problems, as demonstrated from the newspaper. This is back when the newspaper had reporters and photojournalists who worked every day to churn out lots and lots of local copy, local news for Binghamton residents. So this is the Evening Press back in the day when there was such a thing. And I'm not making this up. It was on page 3, Friday, March 8th, 1974. As my good friend Richard Wolfe would say, ripped from the headlines. This is the story. Front Street Flash drops his drawers. Remember, this is back in conservative times. This is before TikTok. This is before MTV. This is before Larry King. Front Street Flash drops his drawers. The story, and I'm sorry if you're sensitive, well then look the other way. Or call up Martha Stewart, but this is the story from exactly 50 years ago today. And you think we have problems today. We have no problems compared to 1974, 50 years ago. I don't know what got into me, the confessing streaker confided. I ended up just bleeping my bleep. Sorry, I'm going to edit some parts of this because I know some of our listeners are very sensitive, and plus it's almost lunchtime. So according to the story by Ciro Scotti in the Evening Press newspaper, back when they had the Evening Press and newspapers with actual reporters and photojournalists take pictures of streakers, says, wearing nothing but sneakers, socks, and a bushy beard, the 22-year-old Johnson City musician streaked across the front of the stage at an Upper Front Street night spot in a flash of flashing light. I'm not making this up. This happened in our hometown. So, yes, we have challenges today. 50 years ago in 1974, we had big problems. We had streakers. Although he preferred to remain unnamed, he did say he was a member of a popular local band which was playing at the club. We got done with our first set, said the streaker, and I just decided to streak. He said he wanted the whole band to streak, but the other four members either did not believe he was going to do it or they did not have the fortitude needed. He said that he did have some misgivings before he kissed his Fruit of the Looms goodbye, but that they disappeared as soon as his dash down Front Street began. The other band members turned the lights off to give him a chance to get into position and then switched them back on as soon as he got in front of the stage. After his sprint in the buff amid the shouts of applause to the crowd on Front Street, he said that he jumped over a counter and returned to the back room where the rest of the band was changing clothes. However, the urge to run around in the bear seemed to have been contagious. The streaker said a short time later, an hour after his streak, two naked patrons were running around the cars in the parking lot. In fact, the streaking spirit so overcame the band that it decided to give away two free tickets to the Seals and Crofts concert at the arena to the next person to streak the club. He said, it happened. At midnight, a guy called Ernie shot out of nowhere, briefly danced naked among the crowd, and then split. He then returned with his clothes on to collect his concert tickets. Another streaking incident occurred farther up Front Street. But the scene was a bowling alley, not a bar. At 10:15 p.m., a young man reportedly completed a 24-lane streak at the Town and Country Bowling Lanes to the amazement of 100 bowlers from the Women's Community Churches League and the Automotive Men's League. Robert Houston, who owns the bowling alley, said it was unbelievable. He witnessed the nude streaker. It was a great one-time experience. Police were at a loss. Law enforcement agencies across Broome County said there was little, if anything, they could do about the streaking that was taking over Binghamton and most of the nation in March 1974. So again, I submit to you, today, 2024, we have challenges, but we certainly don't have any of the problems that America had half a century ago. So we're up to the challenge. It's 11:15. I'm Bob Joseph.
From the Galt Auto Studios, this is WNBF News Radio AM 1290. Also available at 92.1 FM. We sell the ultimate driving machine at Galt BMW.
First News Binghamton.
Quiet Island. This is Bob Joseph, your host. Oh, wait, that's a different station from a different era. It's back when they had elevator music. Well, that era's over. End it. Okay. Your Quiet Island. 1120 Live with Bob Joseph. We're joined now by Congressman Mark Molinaro. Welcome back to the program.
That was such a soothing promotion, and then I'm shocked into alertness when I hear your voice.
There you go. It got your attention. That's almost as good as 5 or 6 cans of that Red Bull energy drink.
I'm a bit of a Celsius fan, but I agree with you.
Anyway, I see what you did there. Anyway, yeah. So the talk of the town is the State of the Union message. What were some of your thoughts about the slightly over hour-long address that was presented by Joe Biden? By the way, I was driving in to work, and I heard on public media. I was listening to a public media station here in Binghamton, so I already have a sense of what you thought about it as far as perhaps overly partisan and sounding very much maybe like a campaign speech or even a campaign commercial.
Yeah, it felt more like I was at the Democratic National Convention than necessarily the State of the Union. And I say this, and folks know it, I'll work with anybody, regardless of party, who's earnest and honest about solving problems. And yeah, I agree with the president. We shouldn't be tinkering with Social Security. We got to save and secure it for American seniors. We got to grow manufacturing jobs. I think, in fact, the model that's occurring throughout the southern tier, Broome County, good example of how we can bring new high-tech jobs, ultimately manufacturing jobs to the region. And of course, we want to grow opportunities for American families. But just about every aspect of the speech was more rhetoric and partisanship. It didn't strike for me, and I think for a lot of Americans, it didn't strike the necessary balance nor outreach to be honest about the problems we face. The crisis at our border is a crisis of the president's making. The 84 executive orders taken to undo and leave open our southern border. He could just take five executive orders to reestablish order at the southern border and secure it. That would really enable us to not only secure the border, but to negotiate a real solution. And so I just ultimately felt it was high on rhetoric, low on deliverables. And I think half of America is going to listen and say he wasn't talking to us. And I just don't think that's the way you lead. I think ultimately you've got to reach across the broad spectrum of Americans to inspire people and encourage working together to solve the problems that face this country and certainly the folks that I represent in upstate New York.
Was there anything at all that surprised you?
Well, I think I'll say that not necessarily surprised, but disappointed. I really felt the president could have used the moment last night to turn to the speaker and to my colleagues and say, we know that you've passed a strict border security bill. It may be stricter than something the president wants to sign on to. So let's start in earnest negotiating a real solution. And I was hopeful the president would have said, you know, I'll take this one step for you. I'll reestablish negotiations for remain in Mexico, or I'll end catch and release at the border, or I'll stop transporting undocumented individuals across the country while we negotiate a real strong border security bill. I was hopeful that I would hear that. We didn't. And unfortunately, it was a missed opportunity and really a moment of cynicism. And I get it, by the way.
But what about his point to so many Republicans? Let's just pass the bill. You had an immigration measure that by virtually every account was going to be the strongest thing that the United States ever had. And it was a missed opportunity. And a lot of people said, well, that's because of his predecessor.
Yeah, well, first of all, we adopted the strictest border security bill, the House did, and I understand the Senate doesn't necessarily like it any more than I'm expected to embrace what the Senate has adopted. The bill was insufficient in a number of ways and would continue to perpetuate a lot of the individual transporting across the country and didn't end catch and release, which is critically important. It's like cashless bail in New York. The same thing occurs at the border, and the Senate proposal, which, by the way, didn't pass the Senate. Cynicism, politics, all aside, the Senate didn't pass a bill. And so I'm comfortable negotiating from our position, but it doesn't mean that we simply abandon what we know is the right policy, secure the border, streamline asylum seeking, and end catch and release. I think we can negotiate from that point. We don't need to abandon it. And so I think the president missed the opportunity. It's just plain out wrong. And again, 80 separate executive orders issued by the president. He took presidential action to create the crisis. Just take a few steps in good faith to shut it down so that we can negotiate at a moment when we can really reduce and secure the border.
Congressman Mark Molinaro, thank you for joining us today. Hope you have a great weekend. Try to relax.
You too. I was out in Binghamton last week for the St. Patrick's parade. We had a great time. Great to see everybody, and look forward to being back in the neighborhood soon.
All right. Take care. We'll keep in touch.
You bet. You will.
WNBF Live on a Friday morning. We have you covered. Lots of voices here. I don't think you're going to hear such a wide variety of voices and views on any other program in the free world. No, even in the unfree world. Especially, you're not going to hear a program like this in North Korea or South Korea or even Canada. So embrace it. Love it. Enjoy it while it lasts. WNBF Live. I'm Bob Joseph. Everybody's welcome here to Binghamton Now.
Breathe.
WNBF Live, I'm Bob Joseph on Binghamton Now, 1130 WNBF Binghamton, on air at 92.1 FM, 1290 AM, streaming WNBF.com. Stay connected using the remarkably free WNBF app. Make sure it's on all your devices, except your kids, because they're not allowed to listen. I think I'm supposed to say that. If you're a kid, don't listen. We welcome back to the program Hadassah Medovetsky and Robert Kavanaugh, members of Binghamton City Council, one of the most exciting city councils in the history of the Parlor City.
Good morning, Bob.
Good morning.
And Hadassah, you are president of City Council. Robert, you are chair of the Finance Committee.
Correct.
So let's talk about the sexy issue of borrowing money for the city's needs. Many of our listeners have called in demanding that we do a segment about borrowing and bonding and what they need to know as city residents and taxpayers. And it just doesn't get much attention and much coverage. But I know the Democrats on City Council are taking a much closer look at how the city pays for projects, especially when it comes to borrowing.
I don't know if you want to start, but so basically we recently had a nearly $12 million bond vote. And I guess the concerns, some of the questions that we raised during work session related to lack of information from departments on, for example, five-year capital improvement plans, right? So this year's bond has a pumper truck and a ladder truck for the fire department. What can we expect we're going to need as plant, you know, we know when certain types of things are going to become obsolete, when that balance of it's more expensive to keep maintaining it than it is to buy new happens. So can we get a list for city council of what we know is coming down so that we can take it into and have that context when making decisions around budget and bonding? We were told that didn't exist. And then there was another piece, and this is part of just how the timelines work, that not, you know, the budget season starts very early and the bonding season has to be kind of regular. So it's certain things have to happen in a timeline and not all the details can be fully flushed out at the time of voting. So what we get in our executive summaries about the bonding projects, some of it's so high level that it's not even clear what we're bonding for. But I understand that that's partly just part of how the timeline works. But some sort of presentations back to city council or something is necessary to make sure we understand what was used. And then, I mean, I think one of the other things we were kind of learning about is there's a lot of approvals for bonds, but they aren't necessarily followed through on. So like trying to understand like what is approved to be bonded for versus what actually is bonded for and trying to tease all of that apart. And I'm going to pass things over to Councilman Kavanaugh, who's a little bit more in the weeds on it.
Well, I want to try and get out of the weeds. So we have an incredibly elaborate budgeting process, and there's hours and hours of budgeting YouTube videos you can go watch from every fall that happen, and council goes through the budget line by line. But in that process, what we don't really get is narrative, is the sort of how departments are, what has happened during that year, what do you see going on. And I'm not trying to advocate for an incredibly elaborate sort of process with the consultants and stuff to you know, develop all these plans. I would settle for a roadmap. What departments see their needs are in the next 5 years. And of course there will be unexpected things. Those will happen. We'll deal with them. But to have a good baseline to work from, we'll be more efficient and we'll be just a better governance overall. And it would, I'll just throw an example. Hadassah mentioned some of the fire trucks. We purchase sort of larger equipment, something almost every year, whether it's a dump truck or a plow truck or this or that. And those get bonded for, and we're paying interest on those bonds, and they're relatively bond speaking for the amounts the city is dealing with. These are relatively small, and the idea, part of the idea of bonding, is that you're spreading out the cost over the useful life and the taxpayer cost over multiple years, so the residents aren't actually paying for stuff that maybe if they move away or pass away or something, that they're not sort of, that burden is not passed along. It's fair. But if we're buying one big thing every year or a few large pieces of equipment every year, instead of bonding for it every year, maybe we can afford that out of pocket if we have a good plan going along.
Well, it is. I mean, what people may not realize, for example, you mentioned purchases, routine purchases, say fire apparatus. And as far as I know, there's probably no vehicle that the city would routinely purchase that would be more costly than, say, a new fire truck. I mean, I've looked at the prices, yeah. And fortunately, most fire vehicles, I think, typically have a useful life of about 20 years, so it can be spread over the course of two decades. At least it's not like a dump truck that may not last that long, but at least those other vehicles are not as astronomically priced as a new fire engine or pumper truck.
Correct. And there's a kind of a middle band as far as the vehicles go. There's kind of a middle band. So there's sort of police cruisers and and regular sort of passenger vehicles and stuff the city will buy, and they just buy them. And then you have the $1 million-plus thing. So this is kind of that middle-of-the-road utility work vehicles and stuff that would be sort of... But this, again, this was just one small example.
Right.
But getting this larger fiscal picture and a narrative of what's going on in projection, that would be very tremendously helpful.
So Binghamton residents might be surprised that this information hasn't already been supplied to council members routinely, to the Finance Committee, and to all members of council. In fact, I'm a bit surprised.
But I do want to say that it's not a matter of this administration. This, from what I have understood, this is how City Hall has functioned.
Like, yeah, and
I don't want that to sound like we're saying...
It's not like you're saying, oh, Jared Cram, it's just something Jared Cram came up with.
No,
this has been going on in recent memory, in terms of this fiscal picture,
my understanding from speaking with people is that this has been across administrations.
Right. And it's also partially a matter, I think you have, in some cases, personnel that have been there for decades and have this institutional knowledge, you know, in their heads, and they have a game plan maybe, but it's not... available, it's not necessarily communicated.
Well, an institutional knowledge is perhaps okay as long as these people who may have been with the city for 10, 20 or more years are still in those positions, but eventually they're either going to retire or move on to some other position, and then when new people come in to try to fill that position, or council members or others try to figure things out, if that institutional knowledge is not documented in some fairly understandable form, then it's going to make things quite challenging.
And I guess on that, you know, obviously, while we want something nice and documented and regularly communicated to City Council from not just us, but going forward, in the meantime, if you're, you know, a department head or somebody who's listening to this that has institutional knowledge, please reach out to City Council members. You know, we're here to listen and speak and learn from you.
So overall, so the new council has been in place for just over 2 months, although we only found out about the 6th District just very recently with a court decision. But over the first couple of months, as the new members of council get acclimated to governing and how things work, have there been any really big surprises from a money standpoint, Mr. Kavanaugh, that have been uncovered so far?
Major surprises from a money standpoint.
Or unpleasant surprises, things that perhaps were unknown to the incoming council members, or maybe not generally known to the public, that you've discovered since January 1st?
I mean, I don't think this is a gotcha or anything, but I just the level of borrowing that we do every year, the having to be very cognizant going forward of our borrowing limits and where we're at with that, which is now going to be in the 70%, you know, over 70% of our borrowing limit after this bond, and the amount of authorizations that are still out there, and that we kind of have to keep an eye on that, retirement of the bond process, you know, a little bit better, and it's just not things people think about because it's not really attention grabbing, but it's the fundamentals of the economics of our city.
Well, is the city getting dangerously close to its borrowing limit?
No, Bob, don't
it's a question. It's a question. It's not a statement.
We are in a relatively healthy place for a size for a city of our size with the age of infrastructure we have to deal with, and again, we have a lot of institutional knowledge that's you know, works on these pieces that need to be worked on year in, year out. But it's not a low number, and it's not a low percentage. So it's we have to be mindful.
Do you think? Sounds like a dumb question, but that's why I'm here. Do you think that it would be helpful at some point to have sort of kind of a public meeting, not exactly like the meeting that was held about the
current
Saratoga.
Concerns, yeah, over in the southeast corner with a supermarket closing and sort of a food desert popping up now because of the Wise closure. But a public meeting, and doesn't have to be long, and it doesn't have to necessarily be complicated, but for those city residents who are actually really concerned, I think all city residents ought to be concerned, but, you know, who would be willing to spend 60 or 90 minutes at City Hall to have council members, maybe you, Mr. Kavanaugh, as chair of the Finance Committee, and perhaps the mayor, and perhaps another administration representative, just to give an overview. Not necessarily, it's not like, yeah, we're now going to debate the city's financing position, and we're going to have a deep discussion about how things should be done, but just overall, sort of as an educational or informational presentation. Is that something that you would view as constructive?
I think that's an excellent idea. And again, you know, the budget hearings are all public, but I appreciate that sort of an executive summary maybe of the budget and the budget process, and that's something that's joint between you know, maybe the mayor, the comptroller, and council would be a public service maybe.
And doing it, say, sometime maybe
in budget season, let's say.
Well, or maybe a little bit ahead of budget season. Of course, that means in the summer when most people don't want to talk about things that are this serious. But at some point, maybe just preceding budget season, and just to say, apart from what the mayor proposes to city council later this year for next year's budget, just to say, this is sort of an overview of how a few things work. Not how everything works, but how the city does go about borrowing and bonding for some major purchases, and even a brief Q&A, not necessarily to be, yeah, we don't want this to turn into some sort of wild debate with moderated by a Jerry Springer wannabe, but something that could be actually informational, because a lot of people, for example, at 11:44 on a Friday morning, they're not listening to this program, but there might be people who could spend an hour or so at an evening meeting at City Hall to learn more about some of these essential things that they're not going to see on TV or read on our website or see in the newspaper, but still, they're important issues.
I think that's a well-taken idea. And even if we only get a dozen people, that's a dozen more citizens that are talking about
this thing,
you know?
Here's my pledge to you. If you schedule something like that, I'll consider going.
Appreciate it, Bob.
Appreciate it, yeah.
Well-worded, too. I'll consider going.
In terms of best practices, I have, you know, reached out to the city comptroller about, you know, an organization that the city already pays into and is involved in that does budget awards and stuff. So I'm curious to sit down and learn a little bit more about how our budget practice aligns or doesn't align with best practices. I did see that we are members of the organization that does that kind of work. So I'm hoping that it'll be a positive once I sit down and get more info on that. And in terms of the budget hearings, in the past years, there have been only a couple of days. And in previous years, previous administrations, there have been more days. So I do expect that we will be modifying the current calendar that's up to add more budget hearing days. So for people who like budget hearings, there might be more of it this year.
All right. I'll have to take a look at that with my scheduler to make sure I can appropriate enough time later this year. Something to look forward to. Gosh, I hope there are no good TV programs on those nights. Anyway, thank you so much.
Adasa
Medovetsky, president of Binghamton City Council. Robert Kavanaugh, the chair of the Finance Committee. Thanks for coming in to give our listeners a bit of an overview.
Yeah,
thanks, Bob, and thanks, Binghamton, for listening.
Yes, appreciate you.
11:46, this is WNBF Live, 92.1 FM, 1290 AM, streaming at WNBF.com. 11:49, WNBF Live with Bob Joseph. Joe and Owego, good morning.
Good morning, sir. I wonder how many people can take a slow trip back into the past, into the days of the Pine Inn, the Topper, Washington Avenue, and a few other places where there were activities in the evening because people had money to spend and they desire to get together and to get out and to relax. I realize that communications and a whole lot of things have changed in the 65 that I was cognizant.
Oh, I think we lost Joe's transmission.
Okay.
Oh, now I can hear you again. You dropped out there for about 12 seconds. So I got the basic gist of the good old days with the Topper on the Avenue and people going out and having fun. And then I at about the point where you said communications have changed, and then we lost you.
I took a deep breath.
Oh, okay. All right. I just thought there was a certain irony that you're talking about communications changing, and I thought maybe we lost the call. So basically, what do you think is that different to me? The people I know still go out at night and have fun and want to be amused and entertained.
The thing is, I keep hearing how good the economy is, and I talk to some people who run independent businesses and so forth, and it seems like after hours, and the hours seem to be about 7 o'clock, nobody's doing anything. Maybe I need to get out more often.
Oh, you should go out. When I go out, I can't believe the crowds. Oh my gosh, at night. Well, I'm not going to say where I go. Then I'm going to wind up, you know, probably getting punched in the noodle. But no, there's. I mean, Owego and Endicott and Binghamton and Johnson City and Vestal. I mean, it's madness out there.
Okay, then I am misguided.
Oh, yeah. No, the economy is booming and zooming. I can't believe. Sometimes I go to places and I say, you know, people call in and say, oh, gas prices are $3.10 a gallon. Woe is us. We have no money. Oh, a Big Mac is $7.99. Oh, we have no money. And I'm looking around saying, yeah, but you have money to hang out here for a few hours and drop 40 or 50 bucks. So, yeah, a lot of people out there with disposable funds for all the people griping.
Much. I enjoy the opportunity to take advantage of the information you provide.
All right.
Have a good day.
Thank you, Joe. Yeah, everywhere I go, and a lot of the places are wondering what we're going to do. I heard there's one place they might actually expand. I don't know if they will, because it would be costly to expand, but somebody was talking about expanding their operation. I said, wow, that's expensive. And then they said, but look at all the people here. And I said, oh, well, okay, it's your place. But now, having said that, I don't think for a minute, I understand that there are some people having some serious challenges. And I'll tell you what, look at how much the newspaper is. That keeps going up. Look at how much the cable is. That keeps going up. Look at how much electricity and natural gas are. They keep going up, man. Your water bill, water and sewer. And yet somehow, the people I know seem to be able to go out and have a good time at night. I don't know. Maybe they're borrowing money. I don't know how they do it, but they do it. It's 11:53. Hi, WNBF. You're on the air. What's your first name? Where are you calling from?
Hi, Bob. It's Martin from Binghamton.
Morning.
Yeah, it was a double whammy this month. You said the press went up and cable again. You know?
Well, what I see with cable and the press, you know, it seems to me they used to raise their prices maybe once a year. Now it seems like they're raising their prices more frequently. Maybe it's just my imagination.
They just don't care. I mean, they don't care. I mean, they're the only game in town. you know? I mean, well, the press is, but, you know, but I'm going to take a long look at this, cutting the cord here. But about the speech last night, early on, I really liked talking about, my sister was a school teacher, then a principal for years out in Bestow. And, but my daughter works downtown and she's been trying, you know, what Biden mentioned was daycare, you know? I mean, she was on a waiting list for a year and a half. And she finally got on. And I know that there's like over 190 people on that waiting list, you know, to get in. And, you know, they say, oh, we want more kids. We want more. Well, where are you going to put them? Who's going to teach them? Biden talked about raising teachers' pay, which they certainly do. You know, I mean, many teachers pay out of their pocket all week long. Bring stuff in for the kids, you know, and many see the commercials on TV where, you know, if it wasn't for school lunches, school breakfast, a lot of these kids wouldn't eat, you know, so they want the kids, but, you know, you got to give out the money too and help them.
Oh, it's true. It's true. Well, I appreciate your observations. Thank you. It's 11:55 WNBF. While I have a moment, I wanted to thank Gail, the director of the Vestal Community Band, also my colleague here at WNBF Radio, Eric, who is a member of the band, and all the other members of the Vestal Community Band. I had been planning for the last few weeks to actually do a news story about the Vestal Community Band. It occurred to me this would be a nice feature story, and so they invited me to observe a Thursday evening rehearsal, and I did last night. I really enjoyed that. Here's just a bit. Here's a snippet of what happened. And this is, you can see the whole thing on Twitter at Binghamton Now. But here's a little, things took kind of an odd twist at one point when I was reporting on the story. All right. So the first time I've ever held, what is this? A stick?
A baton.
Of course it's a baton. Okay. Yes. So this is my first time ever. By the way, first time also ever in Vestal High School inside. I've been here to football games with the great UE Vestal rivalry games, but first time inside the building. Okay, so I have baton in hand. Now tell me what I have to do.
Okay, so it's going to be one, two, ready, play. Okay. All right, it's up to you now.
All right. That's all you need to see on video. I had the camera shut off. Yeah, I've never directed a thing in my life. Well, actually, I have directed some little community plays. But so that was the first time, as I said, that I ever held a baton. One of the members makes batons, and they gave that to me as sort of a keepsake of my visit at the rehearsal with the Vestal Community Band. And they, by the way, will be performing next week at the Oakdale Commons. So they were doing a rehearsal last night, and I heard, I didn't hear everything, that will be part of their concert next week, next Thursday night at the Oakdale Commons. Near, I believe it's near JCPenney. I think they're going to start it at 7 on Thursday night, but great music. And several dozen people were on hand last night at Vestal High School for the rehearsal. It brought back a lot of good memories. I haven't played a musical instrument in a long time since I was in high school. I miss it, but I just haven't played, but I'll tell you, I'm tempted to get back into it. We'll see. Anyway, check out the little video on Twitter at Binghamton Now. You could see that. Thanks again to Gail and everybody with the Vestal Community Band. It was a lot of fun. We'll have a story coming up this afternoon about the band on WNBF.com. Bob Joseph, have a great weekend listening to WNBF.
This is News Radio 1290 AM, WNBF Binghamton. Now on 92.1 FM, W221 EJ Binghamton, a Town Square media station.